My name is Jenna Birch, and I'm the Director of Alumni Engagement here at the Westchester University Foundation. Thank you for joining us for our lecture and tour series, Beyond the Bell, Philadelphia's Global Heritage. Before we begin, I would like to let everyone know that the next event will be on Wednesday, March 1st, and will focus on the musical heritage of Philadelphia. You can register and view the recordings of these events on the Alumni Association's website, wcualumni.org. Please remain on mute until the end of this presentation, at which time you'll be invited to provide feedback and questions related to the subject, or feel free to pop those questions right into the chat as we'll be monitoring those. For the best experience, we recommend having your viewing screen set to speaker, which will allow you to view the presentation at the largest format. This can be found on the top right-hand corner of your screen. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce Museum Director Michael D. Giovine.
All right. Hello and welcome. Thanks for being here. Thank you to those in the audience. Doesn't look like much, but we have a bunch of audience also on Zoom. So thank you too for those who are zooming in today. I'm Michael DeJovine. I'm the director of the Museum of Anthropology and Archaeology and a professor of anthropology here at Westchester University. We are not in the. This is part of the. Programming around the Beyond the Bell exhibition that my student co-curators put on last semester, and is open currently in the Museum of Anthropology and Archaeology at the Mellon Library. And actually, for those of you in attendance, we have a reception and a gallery tour right after this, so we'll all go over together afterwards. I wanted to say a few words, though, about where we are before introducing our guest speaker today. We're not in Old Library, we're in Phillips Autograph Library. So actually, I'll just, since you got the students here, who's Phillips? Yeah.
So Phillips is the fourth principal of Westchester Elementary School, and he took like a habit of buying first editions of books and then sending them to the authors so that they would be signed. Hence why this was founded as the Autograph Library with all these books.
Yeah, so George Phillips was the fourth principal. If you didn't hear, I don't know if were you able to pick that up? Okay, so I don't have to repeat it. So we do have on display, I mean, the connection that we have, especially to, you know, Philadelphia area legacy of slavery and abolition, is that we have the unfortunate honor of being last place that Frederick Douglass spoke before he passed away. Is that on?
No.
Hello.
You don't need me anywhere. I don't need you, so you can hear me just fine. I project. So anyway, we have the honor, I guess, you could say, the last place that Frederick Douglass spoke before he passed away. The reason for this is actually because of this room. So George Morris Phillips, our fourth president or principal of the normal school, as McLaren said, would collect these first edition books. He'd buy the book and then send them off to the author. So he sent it to Leo Tolstoy, Russia, and Jules Verne in France and everyone else. And he sent it to Frederick Douglass, who was the most photographed, most popular person at the time, even more than Abraham Lincoln and everyone else. And Frederick Douglass was very nice and signed his autobiography and mailed it back. And actually they began a nice friendly correspondence back and forth between the two, where he eventually asked him, hey, when you're coming through on a speaking tour, would you stop at the Westchester Normal School to speak? And so he did, and he fell ill right before he was speaking and kind of was guilted into continuing anyway, just to talk here. And then I can't remember, was it 10 days, about 10 days later, it was less than 2 weeks later, he did pass. So we do have right outside of this building, which was built after Phillips passed away, is the statue of Frederick Douglass by one of our professors emeritus. We'll see that as we walk by as well. But anyway, I wanted to have the pleasure really of introducing Gwen Ragsdale. She's the executive director of the Lest We Forget Museum of Slavery in Philadelphia. It's one of the only museums of slavery with authentic artifacts, and certainly the only one in Philadelphia. And of course, our connection here is that she graciously lent us an artifact that you'll see on display in the Beyond the Bell exhibition. And so we are grateful for you, of course, to come here. And I also do want to thank a couple of groups that made this possible, the Anthropology Club, Westchester University, the Department of Anthropology Sociology, the, I got like a big list here, the Institute on Race and Ethnic Studies, And the Frederick Douglass Institute, in addition, of course, to the foundation and the Alumni Association that's hosting this event. So we were really grateful for everyone for making this possible. We're so looking forward to your talk. So without further ado, I'll pass over to you.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you so much. That's thanks for inviting me here. Michael visited the museum. It's been, I think it was over the summer that you visited me. And he was surprised to see the number of artifacts that we have. We have been told by the Smithsonian in Washington that we may have the most extensive collection of slavery hardware. At first, we were told on the East Coast. Then we were told, well, maybe on the West Coast, they have another museum, but it's not called a slavery museum. In fact, as Michael said, we are the only museum of slavery in the Philadelphia region. But the Smithsonian has told us that we may have the most extensive collection of slavery hardware in the United States. So I'm going to answer our most asked question first, which is, so how did you get all of these things? My husband, J. Justin Ragsdale, is the founder of the Lest We Forget Slavery Museum and the one who collected these items. He started collecting slavery hardware over 60 years ago. He became interested in the hardware. And when I say hardware, I'm talking about slave shackles, branding irons, chains, and other forms of ironware that were used on enslaved Africans. So when you understand how different coming to America was for these enslaved Africans, I hope that you will gain an appreciation and at least an awareness of how different it was for these people who were captured and forcibly brought to this part of the world and other parts of the world and held in bondage for hundreds of years. I also want you to understand that as Americans, we all came from somewhere else, including the Europeans. The difference is the Europeans, for the most part, came here willingly. They came here looking to search for, and in many cases, achieve the American dream. For enslaved Africans, again, they were captured and forcibly brought here and held in bondage for hundreds of years. These are the ancestors. These are the descendants of today's African-American people. And it's important to understand that they were people. For them, it was an American nightmare. That's where we pick up the story. I have brought a few of our pieces with us, with me, a few of them on the back table, and you may have seen a piece that I have loaned to Westchester University that I'm sure that we'll see during the tour. So let me get back to telling you how my husband got started collecting these items. I'm used to moving around, so I feel a little stunted, but I understand that we're on Zoom, so I'm gonna behave and just kind of stand still here. But my husband, even though he grew up in Philadelphia, his family used to send him south to spend time with his great uncle, who lived in a place called Rock Hill, South Carolina. His uncle's name was Uncle Bella. Now, Uncle Bella was a very old man, but his mind was very sharp. He was very alert. And my husband loved the stories that his Uncle Bob told him. So he looked forward to these trips visiting Uncle Bob over the summer, because Uncle Bob had so many stories that he told him. And he told him stories about what his life was like growing up in the Jim Crow era. And you know, the Jim Crow era followed the emancipation of the enslaved people, but laws were created that continued to keep them oppressed. And whenever he would tell my husband stories, he kept referring to this man who he called Massa. He talked about Massa all the time. He would say Massa this and Massa that. For a while, my husband thought that was the man's first name. It wasn't until he realized that because of Uncle Bob's heavy Southern accent that he was actually saying master. Now, one of the stories that his Uncle Bob told him kind of stuck with him. He said, Massa took me off to the war and made me a soldier when I was just a boy. Now, at the time, my husband thought maybe he was talking about World War II or maybe even World War I. Because something that happened later on, he realized that Uncle Bob was talking about the Civil War. Uncle Bob also kept a trunk in the rear room of his house.
But every time my husband would go near it, he would chase him away, which made him even more curious. You know how kids are when you tell them you don't want them to touch something or go near something that makes them even more curious. He said sometimes when his uncle wasn't around, he would hit the lock on the trunk, hoping maybe the top would fly open, but of course it never did. Now, Uncle Bob lived to be 109 years old, which is really quite remarkable, but not that unusual. I'm sure many of you have heard about Black Wall Street before, right? There are still three living survivors of Black Wall Street today, two of which are brother and sister. The sister is 106, and her brother is 102. Now, it speaks to the strength of these people and how strong they had to be coming up at such an oppressive time. So when my husband was in his early 20s, he decided to return to Rock Hill to see if he could find the house that he had spent so many fond memories with his Uncle Bob. We had a hard time finding the house at first because the tree had actually fallen over on it and tree branches and everything were blowing out of the windows. But because he was familiar with the area, he was able to locate the house. Now, once he got inside, what do you think the first thing he looked for was? You're absolutely right, it was that trunk. And it was still there. As soon as my husband saw that trunk, he got excited. He pulled it open, pried it open, which wasn't very difficult to do because the weather had gotten to it. When he first opened the trunk, he saw a small plow. I asked my husband, why in heaven's name would your uncle have a small plow in his trunk? He says he remembers his Uncle Bob telling him that when he was a young man, he used to lease himself out to the white farmers in the area to plow small portions of their land. He said he had an old mule for a while. When that old mule died, Uncle Bob said he would put that harness on his back and literally plow that land with the strength of his own body. Now that not only spoke to Uncle Bob's strength, but it spoke to the fact that Uncle Bob was an entrepreneur. And I'm proud to say that entrepreneurship still runs very deep in the Ragsdale clan, all right? So he keeps digging around in this trunk and he hits something hard. And he realized it was a chain. So he starts pulling on that chain, and attached to that chain was a slave shackle. Now he did not know at the beginning, at the start, that that was an actual slave shackle. However, my husband was quite a voracious reader. And he read a lot of books about slavery, quite frankly, because he wanted to know how our people got here. It wasn't something that he learned in school or even in the books that he read. And he knew that many of these people were shackled in iron shackles. As a matter of fact, when my husband started collecting, he hooked up with a band of collectors who were returning to the South and looking for things on the former battlefields during the Civil War. And at first, they were a little skeptical of him. Who was this Black kid by that time? He was, like I said, in his late teens, early 20s. My husband, to describe him, is a fair-skinned, green-eyed, red hair Black man. He doesn't have any hair anymore, but he had red hair growing up. And he was my husband's very overly talkative man. So he kind of lured him into accepting him into their group. And they told him that they were looking for items that were left over during the Civil War on these battlefields. My husband just started going and looking for these items too, and found a canteen. They were so excited. So that was what encouraged them and actually enamored them to showing my husband how to collect, because he knew nothing about collecting. They didn't even know that he was actually interested in collecting slave shackles. He said one time he was in one of the guys explained to him was a barn. My husband realized that it probably wasn't a barn, but a former slave cabin. And as he was looking around, one of the guys said, Joe, You seem very fascinated by all of these iron objects. Here's a horse bridle, and threw it at my husband. But when he caught it, he realized that it was an actual slave shackle. That shackle that he found in his Uncle Bob's trunk is what sent him on a quest to collect more slave shackles and other forms of ironware. Now, again, we realize after many inquiries that was a slave shackle. It's a very rare shackle because it had an iron collar. We found out through much of our investigation that collar would sit on the neck of an enslaved male. It has a leather piece inside of it. Now, I have 5 sons and a daughter. One of my sons happens to be a chemist. He graduated from the University of Pitt with 2 degrees, one in chemistry and one in science. He did a DNA on that leather collar and found human DNA on it. We have not been able to trace it back to Ragsdale DNA, so we can't say for certain that Uncle Bob was forced to wear it, but we do know that at some point an enslaved person was forced to wear that collar. Now, attached to the end of the chain that was attached to this collar is a 40-pound ball. Now, imagine this collar would sit around the neck of an enslaved male, we found out. Most of the shackles, quite frankly, were used mostly on the males. The women, in many cases, were lightly shackled, and sometimes not at all, because on the slave ships, the European men who worked on the ship were lured into working on the slave ship by the King of England at the time, who had trouble getting Europeans to, you know, go and agree to go and work on the slave ship. First of all, it took 2 to 3 months to get from the shores of Africa into the shores of North America. Nobody wanted to do that. So he went into the prison and he offered the prisoners their freedom. And in order to make it more inviting to them, he told them that while you were on the ship, you could have access to any of the females. Many of them were pregnant before they got to their final destination. Now, I skipped around a bit, so forgive me, but I just want to make sure that I cover all of the bases here so that you could understand where I'm coming from. So getting back to that shackle, again, the collar would sit on an enslaved male's neck. And this 40-pound ball at the end of the chain would hang low, so low that in fact, it would hit that enslaved male in his private area. That would deter him from running away or perhaps even walking away, all right? Again, when the Smithsonian first broke ground, they came to us because they heard about my husband's extensive collection of slave hardware and they wanted to borrow some. They wanted that particular shackle, but that had too much of a fondness for it. But we did loan them other shackles. So if you ever visit the Smithsonian, look at the shackles on loan from Lest We Forget Slavery Museum. That shackle, again, is what inspired my husband to want to collect more slave shackles. That's how he was able to acquire so many. Some he found, because when he started collecting in the late 50s and early 60s, there were still slave shackles in former slave plantations where the big house still existed. And history books tell him that behind the big house were the slave cabins. So he found some things there, all right? But we have shackles that were made in Europe in the 1800s. How do we know that? Because the history books tell us that they were striking iron in Liverpool, England in the 1800s. The shackles that we had from that early period probably came over on a slave ship on enslaved Africans because my husband found them here in America. So again, it's important that you recognize this period of American history. Now, I know this is Black History Month, But I'm not here to discuss Black history with you. I'm here to talk to you about American history, a sad and tragic period of American history, but American history nonetheless. Slavery happened. It's not something that we could ignore or erase. It's important that you recognize that. And when you look at these artifacts, and by the way, I have brought a few of my artifacts with me that are on the back table that you can look at, and the artifact that are on loan here. You realize immediately how different coming to America was for millions of enslaved Africans. Now, I share this information with you, not to anger you or to make you uncomfortable, but I will tell you that if you get a little uncomfortable, I make no apologies, because this is American history. It really, really happened. It's not a fantasy. It's no more of a fantasy or a made-up story than the Holocaust was. When you go to Germany and you visit those ovens, you know that people died in those ovens. The same thing holds true when you look at these artifacts. So, again, I just want you to understand this period of American history. Now, I don't know how much time I have, Michael, because I don't want to take too much time, because I'm going to be perfectly honest with you. This, of course, is the busiest time of the year for me. I've been talking so much that I'm getting tired of hearing my own voice. But I am so glad to be here. And I'm especially glad to be here because you guys are bringing attention to Frederick Douglass, who was born into slavery. He was born into slavery. But when he was a young boy, his white slave mistress taught him how to read the Bible. But he wanted so much to learn that when he got a little older, he would steal bread from the kitchen and run down to the road and wait for the poor white children to come home because he knew they were hungry. And he would say, "I'll give you a piece of bread if you teach me everything that you learned in school today." He kept on reading and learning. He became so educated that he became a famous orator. I don't know if you know this history, but Lincoln invited him into the White House where they would, against the protests of his cabinet members, where they would have long discussions about race and race relations. Now, Frederick Douglass was quick to tell people that Lincoln was no friend of mine. As a matter of fact, and I'm using my words, he considered him a frenemy, all right? They said that Frederick Douglass was the one who convinced Lincoln that if he wanted to stop the Civil War, he needed to free the slaves. So again, Frederick Douglass played such a pivotal role in this period of American history. And to see that book and to hear that story about the fact that, I don't even know this, Michael, you may have told me this before, that this was his last stop before he perished, that's amazing to me. That's amazing to me. But you do know that the abolitionist movement was made up of many people, black and white. It was compassionate whites. They didn't think that slavery, believed that slavery was wrong. Many of them were Quakers, but many of them were not. I'm going to give you another little hint. Many of the white females were horrified by slavery because they grew fond of the little enslaved children and their mothers, all right? Many of them convinced their husbands, a few of them, I'm not going to say many of them, but a few of them convinced their husband to free their slaves. So these women deserve some credit because many of them, like I said, were the original abolitionists, all right? Weren't not to those white abolitionists, and a lot of Black people don't like to hear me say this, but I'm going to say it anyway, we might still be in slavery because they were the ones who convinced the world that slavery was wrong, along with other abolitionists like William Still, who was considered the father of the Underground Railroad. He was a in Center City, downtown, near the Liberty Bell, all right? Where we have a robust Black community, free Black community, where Blacks roam free here in Philadelphia. There was a law in Philadelphia that said, you could bring your slaves here, but you couldn't keep them here longer than 6 months. George Washington was careful to not keep his slaves in Philadelphia for that long, for no longer than 6 months. He would transition them out and bring other slaves in. There is an edifice right there at the corner of 6th and Market, right across from the Visitors Bureau, which is called the President's House. It used to be where George Washington's house lived, which was, all right? And you can walk around that edifice. They actually have little monitors where you have people who were reenactors talking about what happened to them during their period of history, all right? Now, one of his slaves, in fact, several of his slaves ran away, but one in particular whose name was Omi Judge. She was brought here. However, she was actually owned by Martha Washington. You may not know this, but it was that many of the white women were the original owners of the enslaved people. They used them as dowries to make them more attractive to be married. Martha Washington had many, many slaves, excuse me. George Washington became a wealthy man when he married Martha Washington because the number of slaves that he acquired because of marrying her. Only Judge overheard Martha Washington tell one of her other relatives that she was going to give her to her niece as a wedding present. Only Judge said, I don't think so. She hooked up with William Still because she heard that William Still kept the names of all the slaves who came through Philadelphia. He kept them in a little booklet. If you ever go to Philadelphia, you must go to see his booklet, which is actually at the Philadelphia Museum, at 13th and Locust. You can actually see his booklet, all right? And they have the names of every slave that came through Philadelphia that he introduced to the conductors, the white conductors along the railroad, all right? She escaped, but do you know that the Washingtons, Martha Washington died first. She spent all of her life looking for Omi. She thought that somebody stole her. She couldn't believe that she ran away. She wouldn't believe it. She said, because Omi was like a sister to me, huh? Some people say that she may have even been her half-sister because she was a fair-skinned Black woman and she had freckles. She was actually a dead ringer for Martha Washington. I haven't been able to find any proof of that, but you know, there was a lot of that going on, all right? But Omi Judge was never found. There are many books written about Omi Judge. So again, if you want to learn more about her, it's very easy to find out information about her. So again, I want you to also understand that we are located in Germantown, 5501 Germantown Avenue, to be exact. We're in the lower level. Thank you so much. We're in the lower level of the historic Germantown Society. There are a consortium of museums and institutions in the Germantown area that comprise of that consortium. There are 18 of us all together. Johnson House is one. That is said to be a former Underground Railroad site where Harriet Tubman came through and hid slaves. And then there's the Cliveden or the Cliveden, depending on where you're from, how you pronounce it, which is an actual former slave plantation that was owned by John Chu, who was Washington's attorney. Just across the street from where I am is what is called the, hold on, I'm having a senior moment here. I can't think of the name of the house. It'll come to me in a moment. You know, we have these senior moments. Nope, Long Fork is down the street from us. But just across the street on the other side of Germantown Avenue was George Washington's first city hall. Germantown played a critical role in Philadelphia history. It was considered the countryside. The leaders would get in their buggies and ride all the way up to Germantown to escape the heat during the summer and the diseases that were plaguing smallpox and things in the city. So many of them had homes up there. Germantown is full of magnificent buildings, some of which could be compared to mansions. You can go one block of Germantown and see all these beautiful homes. And then the next block, it's just blighted, you know, with homes where many of the Black people live. But it's a diverse community, and it has been diverse for many, many years, all right? So again, understand that don't just come to Philadelphia and visit the Liberty Bell. Philly is more. As a matter of fact, I shouldn't even tell you this because I'm planning on having t-shirts made of my slogan. Philly is more than just a craft bell. Germantown has a rich history. Come and visit us. You could spend a day in Philadelphia just visiting all the different museums and institutions, including Rumblethorpe, which is a former farm. The Stenton Museum, all right, where a slave by the name of Dinah fought off the soldiers during the Revolutionary War. She hid many of the beautiful pieces and the pieces that she knew that the soldiers would steal, all right? She was the one on the plantation there at Stenton. So again, Germantown has a very rich history. So I not only encourage you to come and visit my museum, which is the Lest We Forget Slavery Museum, but all the other museums and institutions in the Germantown area. So I think I've given you a little overview as to who we are and what we do. So I hope that you will come and visit us. If we have time, Michael, I will be glad to take any questions that you may have at this point in time about my husband and how he got started, or just in general. I will be perfectly honest with you, I am not a historian. I'm simply a collector that was actually brought into this by my husband, all right? I didn't start out as a collector, but I became intrigued with it. In fact, let me tell you another funny story. My husband has been collecting these artifacts for many years. When I married him, he had already been collecting them. One time, and every time he found something, he would come up already so excited. He came in one time and I had just set the table with the beautiful, I'm from the Bahamas. And if you know anything about the Bahamas, the islands, we have beautiful linen. I had a beautiful linen tablecloth on the table that I had set up. And I had the children around the table. My husband came in all excited with this bag, this dirty bag. And he dumped this dirty bag in the middle of my dining table, right on my beautiful linen tablecloth. I said, calm down, calm down. He said, do you know what you're looking at? I said, stop. He said, that's a slave shackle. Somebody was forced to wear this. Somebody who probably our ancestors. We owe it to them to recognize these shackles. Stop collecting them. You didn't. All right. So again, understand how we came here and what it means to have, how it still continues to have an impact, quite frankly, on African American communities all over the United States. So again, I'm going to take a call of order. If any of you have any questions or comments, Tuesday through Saturday, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., and Sunday, 12 to 4. We're open by appointment only. So you can go to our website. Website address is, of course, you know, www.lw, F as in forget, S as in slavery, M as in museum.com. It's very simple. It's the acronym for the name of our museum. All right. You can actually book a tour on our website, or you can call 215-205-4324 to schedule an appointment. We're small, so we can only hold 20 to 25 people at a time, all right? So visit us. I think that you will be quite intrigued and educated. That's what we do, all right? Any other questions or comments? Yes, sir.
If you might answer the question. Oh, by the way, the building that
you've been
talking about across the street.
The Morris House. I thank you. That you gave those moments. That's the Morris House. As a matter of fact, it's closed, but they open up during the spring and summer. That house is said to be George Washington's city hall when he stayed in Germantown. All right. So it's very historic. But yes.
With the increased interest in this period of history and looking at when your husband first started collecting, A, is he still collecting? And
yes.
B, are these materials, because of what I presume is a higher interest, less available, harder to come by than they might have been in the 1950s and 60s.
To answer your question, yes, my husband still collects, but he's not out scavenging the battlefields anymore. But sometimes we get phone calls from white people. Artifacts in their family. And have had these artifacts in their family for many, many years. We have a lantern that is said to be a lantern from the Underground Railroad. From a white family who lives and still lives in Broomall, Pennsylvania. They were excavating their grandmother's home. When they got to the sub-basement, they realized that it was a former Underground Railroad site. In it, they found a lantern as well as a slave shackle. They have donated it to the museum, so you can see it there, all right? We also have what are called Jim Crow items, salt and pepper shakers, right? That are made to just make Black people look subservient. They're all in servant positions. You know, you have the nanny dressed in the apron, you know, and they have, you know, the man dressed as a chauffeur or caterer or whatever, but they're all in servant positions. One of the young white girls, she said to me, she called, I grew up with this racist salt and pepper shaker on my grandmother's table. And I would tell her, Grandma, that's racist. And she said, well, I like it. When her grandmother died, she donated it to the museum because she said that this needs to be in the museum, and she was so afraid that it would get lost. So to answer your question, yes, my husband still collects. So we get calls all the time, but every now and then, and sometimes you get a lot of reproductions because there are a lot of reproductions out there, but he has an eye. As a matter of fact, when the Smithsonian gets things, we get calls from some of their curators to ask them to authenticate them, all right? Because he can look at something and say, oh, that's not real, you know? Because they have a lot of people that just reproduce these things. Yes. Used for kids? Okay, I need to be real careful how I answer this question. First of all, we do have a lot of young children that come to our museum. We also, by the way, have a traveling slavery exhibit. But if you can't visit us, we bring our collection to you. Right now, in addition to museum tours, I have traveling exhibits that I do at corporations, schools, universities, places of worship, synagogues, mosques. And we do a lot of the schools. Just last week, I was at Germantown Academy. I think they're in Norristown. So when you ask me if we have tours for children, yes. But I always encourage the people who call to schedule an appointment to make sure that these children have been given some information about this period of American history, whether they what may be shown the film Roots. I read a book about slavery in schools. And I hesitate to say that because at this point in time, we may not be even having that in schools. And that really, really disturbs me. It should disturb you too. All right. So again, and I also recommend fifth grade and up. Little children, they don't really have a real understanding, and it's hard for me to describe to them how horrible slavery is, and it was horrible. But I will tell you that I have some adults who come to the museum, and they don't come with the right spirit. First of all, when you come to Lest We Forget Museum of Slavery, you should know what you're coming there. You should know what you got. The name's in the jingle, all right? It's not the Museum of Dinosaurs and Butterflies. Give you a quick story. A set of grandparents that came to visit, they were from Kentucky. That should have given me a clue right there. Their adult grandchildren saw my brochure. I have some brochures at the visitor center right downtown there. They picked up my brochure and they said, oh, we want to go to the slavery museum. The grandfather, he said, okay. But the grandmother, she was very reluctant. She tried to talk him out of it, all right? She came anyway by one of my tour guide friends. And when she came in, I could tell that she was very hesitant. She was the last one to come through the door. The kids were smiling and eager to learn. The father, the grandfather was very congenial. As I'm talking and showing these slave artifacts, she kept clearing her voice, kept clearing her throat. She kept going, and she would touch her virtual pearls, you know, grabbing her neck. At one point, I saw her say something to the tour guide who escorted her out. When she came back in, I was at a period of the tour where we have an actual Ku Klux Klan robe that was given to us by a white man who said his father was a devout member of the Klan, but he never told his children or grandchildren. He begged my husband to take that robe and put it in our museum so that our visitors would know that not all white people were racist. He says, because I am not racist, and I never told my children or grandchildren that their grandfather was a racist. Anyway, when she came back in the museum, I was just showing that robe. I guess you couldn't take it anymore. And she said to me, did he really survive this? I was stunned. In fact, I thought she was joking. I couldn't believe she said that to me. So I didn't know how to react. So without thinking, I said, ta-da! Her grandchildren clapped. Even her husband started laughing. I think she got the joke, all right? Because her mood never changed. But I say that to say, you have to come there with the right spirit. Come there understanding that you're gonna learn about slavery. And it wasn't about Black people who are happy on the plantation playing instruments and dancing around, all right? You have families that were separated. Frederick Douglass lost contact with his mother because he was separated from her, all right? He remembered in his young mind that she would come and sleep with him overnight sometimes. But when he woke up in the morning, she was gone because she was enslaved in another plantation. These stories really make you understand how horrible life was for these people. And again, this went on for hundreds of years. That trauma still is internalized in me and many other African Americans, all right? So it's important, again, that you understand that, understand who we are and where we are. All right? Yes, you have another question? Yes, we actually have a very small leg shackle that was used on a child who had been auctioned away from its mother. The shackle is so small that it could fit around a little ankle. And you can just imagine, it's hard to conceive of somebody coming up with a shackle to put on the child that had been auctioned away from its mother to to keep it from crawling away or toddling away. Yes. And auctions, you know, were a major event. We're talking human beings that were sold, bought and sold just like chattel property, all right? We have documents that show you the costs that were put in these people's heads. You know, a slave could go from anywhere from $1,500 to $200, depending on what that slave master thought they were worth. An enslaved woman, a young girl, anywhere from 15 and up, any women who were in their breeding years could be sold for a good amount of money because of the number of children that she could give the slave master at no expense to him, all right? A man who has developed a different skill, like a carpenter, he would go for a significant amount of money. But maybe a laborer who was just picking cotton could be sold for a little less. But yes, there were prices put on these people's heads. Any other questions or comments? Yes. Is there any part of the Underground Railroad that is maintained? Yeah, there's an Underground Railroad Museum in Cincinnati, Ohio. Yeah, Underground Railroad sites, like I just told you, the Johnson House, where Harriet Tubman hid the slaves. And again, some of them are being discovered, like that white family that I told you that found that their grandmother's house was a former Underground Railroad site. Yeah, there's still many. And remember, the Northeast is full of Underground Railroad sites because these people, some led by Harriet Tubman, and by the way, Harriet Tubman is my hero. You know what I call her? The original gangster. That's what we call in the hood, Black people that really know what they're doing. In fact, the word woke that you hear a lot today originated in the Black community. But some officials have taken that word woke right out of the Black community, which means to be aware, means to be informed, and turned it into a pejorative, all right? So when you hear the word woke, understand where it came from, what it really, really means, all right? But again, these people walked all the way from the South, through Virginia, through Pennsylvania, through New York, into Canada, on foot. Just to be free. That's how passionate these people were about their freedom. And by the way, when I talk about Harriet said she could have saved more slaves if they knew they were slaves. You know what she meant by that? If my mother was a slave, and the person next to me, another person's mother was a slave, and that other person's mother was a slave, all you knew was slavery. They made a movie about it, but they didn't show this in the movie. When her brother threatened to go back to the plantation, she put a gun in his mouth, said, I'd rather blow your brains out than to let you go back into slavery, go back to the plantation. So that's why I call her. And she died of natural death. She received money because she worked, her pension, because she worked as a scout during the Civil War and died a natural death. So she was something else. I just admire her so much. Anybody else? Any questions or comments? Sorry. I meant to turn my phone off. I'm trying to turn it off now.
Can you tell, especially for those on Zoom, what we have up in the back there? Maybe share when can we hold it up?
Well, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to leave the camera or do you want Michael to go and can you flip the camera?
This is what is called a contraband shack. The Union Army was shocked after they won the war to find so many liberated slaves who started coming to their encampments looking for refuge, all right? They didn't know what to do. Some of them, if you see this picture here, this is a photo, as you see here. You can't see the man sitting next to him, but it's actually a Union officer with a young Black boy next to him.
And when you look at his face, he looks so sad to me, all right? But they considered these people contraband, all right? They didn't know what to do with them. They started using some of them as, you know, laborers to clean up after the camp, all right? If they thought that any of them would run away, they put them in shackles. This is an actual shackle that was used during the during that time. It's called a contraband shackle, all right?
Here's another shackle.
That was used on a slave plantation. These shackles would be put on these enslaved people, again, to keep them from running away and or to punish them. Now, I'm not as good as my husband is at showing how these shackles were utilized, because he really gets into the fact that these shackles were almost like hooks, you know? This piece would go in here, they would put a lock on it. Sometimes these shackles would be attached to the back of a horse or the back of a wagon. And these slaves were pulled behind that horse or wagon to their destination, unless they were going long distance, all right? But again, when you look at these shackles and or hear these shackles, it should make you understand that somebody was forced to wear this. A human being was forced to wear this, all right? The shackle that I have on loan here is an actual Middle Passage shackle. I don't know whether we have photos of it or they'll put it on the website later on, but the Middle Passage shackle, which is on loan, as I said here, was used on, again, mostly enslaved males. They rarely had enough shackles for more than one slave. So that shackle would be shared. One rung would come off the shackle. There are two rungs on it. One rung would come off and go around the ankle of one enslaved male. The other rung would come off and go around the ankle of another enslaved male. And a lock was put on it, all right? A long chain would connect a whole row of enslaved people together, all right? But if one of those Africans decided to jump overboard, what do you think the rest of them are going? And that happened more often than not, all right? So you can see that Middle Passage chair that is still here alone today. Yes.
Do you have plans to expand the museum to explore the skills brought to America from Africa and tools developed by the slaves? Many of the colonies failed before the introduction of slavery. The cotton revival crops survived because the slaves brought their skills.
Okay, let me stop you because I can't keep up with all. All right. However, I think I heard you say some of the companies and things. Yes, Domino Shirt, which is the corporate offices are in Baltimore, Maryland, were one of the largest. It's the largest sugar company today. I think it may have changed, but I think they still are. But they dealt a lot in slavery. All right, Domino Sugar. I'm really taking you guys really deep here. In fact, I'm not even going to tell you anymore because I need you to come to the museum. I'm not going to give you my entire tour here. But yeah, there were many, many companies. And many of those companies, the families who started out with these companies are still living off the generational wealth that they earned from slavery. All right? That's something that you need to understand, all right? They're still living off the generational wealth that they earned from slavery. Now, of course, they're no longer dealing in slavery, but they made so much money over time that they were able to start other economies around the world. You know what else that wealth did? It helped them to establish white supremacy that would live on for decades. And here we are. I think I've said enough. So I encourage you to come and visit us. I have some flyers here that you can take with you. Again, we're located 5501 Germantown Avenue in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We're open Tuesday through Saturday, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. and Sunday 12 to 4 by appointment only. Admission is $20 per person, and we accept cash or charge. The tour, by the way, lasts about an hour and a half. So give yourself some time to come in and visit us, all right? If you know anything about the Germantown area, wherever you're located, how many of you have ever heard of Uncle Bobby's Coffee House and Bookstore? It's owned by Mark Lamont Hill. He's a former CNN correspondent, black guy. He owns that bookstore and a coffee house. It's located right across the street from us. It's become one of Philly's hotspots, all right? So we're right across the street from Uncle Bobby's. Thank you so much again for having me. I hope I haven't horrified you to the point where you won't come to visit us. Come. You owe it to yourself to see what we have and to learn about this period of American history. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks so much for coming all the way out here.
I appreciate it.
We really appreciate it. I do want to a couple of announcements really quickly. So definitely come take a look. Gwen has put out some other things. And we also have Frederick Douglass's autobiography here as well. So do take a look at that, one of our own prized possessions. We have other Frederick Douglass artifacts, but they're in special collections, and it's hard to get out. At least this, we didn't have to leave the room. So,
I also wanted to say that. I have put together little known history fact booklets. You notice I didn't say Black History? History fact booklets. Little interesting facts that you may not read in most history books, like how slavery in America got started, the shared history of the Irish and Africans, how they have a shared history, how a slave insurance was sold to plantation owners to make money off the slave that they may have lost, and many other information in here. Is a lot of good. You get over 50 documents, a little known history fact. I brought some of them here. It's just $20. I accept cash or charge. I brought my little doohickey with me. If anybody's interested in our booklet, or you can order them online. Our website address is F as in forget, S as in slavery, M as in museum.com.
All right. Thank you. Thanks so much. And again, I want to invite everybody who's here to come back with us to the Museum of Anthropology and Archaeology and Old Library. We have we have a reception, so we have food out down there, so please do come. We have enough for everyone and then some. And then also we're going to do a little gallery tour, and we have one of our curators, Virginia, who actually worked with Gwen to put together the slavery and abolition exhibit in the Beyond the Bell, will be there as well. So we'll do a little gallery tour for you. You can see that. You can also see one of the oldest abolitionist texts from Philadelphia, from Ephrata Cloister, which is another one of the big things that we have on display. So please do come back, and please join us again. Jenna, you're going to talk about it. March 1st is our next Zoom-only lecture tour in the gallery. So we're going to have some students take you around. We promise, if you did Zoom in the last one, it's a little hard to see the artifacts, but we're going to have a different camera crew, and we'll be Zooming in on March 1st for a history of music heritage in Philadelphia. And then later on in the month, we'll do with John Baker, we'll be talking about the artistic heritage of Philly. So please join us for those two as well. And again, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
All right, thanks.